Dr. Iskeliyeva is part of team of fetal medicine ward at the Dr. Sterev Hospital. She is the first Bulgarian specialist to study under the European program of the European Board College of Obstetricology, EPCOC, at the same hospital. Our hospital is the first private medical institution in Europe and the only Bulgarian hospital accredited for training in obstetric and gynecology from EPCOC. Dr. Iskeliyeva's interests are focused on the high-risk pregnancy, prenatal medicine, and fetal morphology, follow-up of pregnancies in patients after ART procedures. Please, Dr. Iskeliyeva, present your lecture.
Thank you, Professor Sterev. It's a pleasure for me to present our data from our research provided in Dr. Sterev Hospital, Sofia. Thank you, dear colleagues. I will present you a part of our data from our research provided in Dr. Sterev Hospital, Sofia. The topic is pregnancy complications after assisted reproductive techniques. The beginning was in 1978 when Steptoe and Edwards announced the birth of the first test tube baby, Louis Brown. The success of assisted reproductive techniques is improving with each passing year. The number of couples with infertility is increasing. Over 5 million children were born after ART. It is known that ART procedures are associated with a higher rate of complications during pregnancy, increased rate of miscarriages, ectopic pregnancies, and adverse perinatal outcome, low birth weight, premature birth defects, placental abnormalities. Main risk factors are sterility, maternal age, endometriosis, PCOS, parity, BMI, thyroid disease. In IVF ICSI procedures, the oocytes and embryos are exposed to supraphysiological levels of estradiol, which is produced by the ovaries in response to injectable gonadotropins. Another risk factor is vascular endothelial growth factor, which levels are also become elevated in humans after ovarian stimulation and maybe have a negative impact on placentation. Both female and male gametes are manipulated during oocyte retrieval and embryo culture, exposing gametes and embryos to an altered environment in earliest and perhaps most susceptible period. Epigenetics involves molecular mechanisms such as DNA methylation and histone modification of chromatin that leads to changes in gene expressions and phenotypic characteristics. The aim of this study is to specify the frequency of certain complications in singleton pregnancies after natural conception and after assisted reproductive technologies. I will present you only three tasks. First one is to calculate the incidence of pregnancies with preeclampsia. The second one is to investigate the pregnancies with gestational diabetes. And the third one was to calculate the percentage of babies with EUGR after ART. We have two groups, our group and control group. In our group, we put women conceived after conventional IVF ICSI procedures, which are 418, and control group, pregnant women after natural conception. We have a retrospective analysis for 5 years period from 2013 to 2018. All patients who underwent IVF ICSI procedures were evaluated by detailed history, clinical examination, and relevant investigations. Patients were followed up closely throughout pregnancy, labor, and delivery. We used different methods, clinical methods, methods of diagnostic imaging, and laboratory methods, and other methods. We used statistic analysis with SPSS program and different tests. We include some parameters: maternal age, body mass index, parity, history of previous pregnancy, history of pre-pregnancy arterial hypertension, history of pregnancy of thyroid disease, polycystic ovary syndrome, endometriosis, characteristics of control ovarian hyperstimulation and embryo transfer, and newborn weight. The first complication that I will present you is intrauterine growth restriction, EUGR, is pathological decrease of intrauterine fetal growth and inability of the fetus to reach its growth potential, or estimated fetal weight under fifth percentile, and has an increased risk of adverse perinatal and long-term outcome. Risk factors: maternal weight, smoking, gestational hypertension, previous pregnancy with preeclampsia, anemia, congenital infections. And ART risk factors are ovarian hyperstimulation, endometrial receptivity, effect of culturing embryos in vitro in a very sensitive phase of their development. On this table, you can see maternal risk factors, placental risk factors, infection as a risk factors, and fetal factors. 3% of ART singleton babies in our research were classified as EUGR. The difference with spontaneous pregnancies, 1%, has significant differences. You can see women with EUGR and women without EUGR in the both groups. What about risk factors and EUGR? We see that maternal age in our group, women over 35 years are almost 70%, in contrast to control group, more than 35 years, we have no patients in this group. What about the parity? In multiparous women, we detect EUGR in 4%, and in primiparous women, we detect EUGR in the similar percent, 3%. In control group, the results are the same. In multiparous and in primiparous women, EUGR we detect in 1%. As we see, in connection with BMI, women with high BMI, women with normal and subnormal BMI, we have the same results without difference between the group in EUGR, in cases with EUGR. In control group, all women with EUGR have normal BMI. Preeclampsia and EUGR. Preeclampsia is a risk factor for normal fetal development and growth. In our R group, women with preeclampsia and EUGR are 9.3%, and women with EUGR without preeclampsia are 2.4%. Women with preeclampsia more often develop EUGR compared to those without preeclampsia. In control group, there is no patients with preeclampsia and EUGR. Main pathological processes are abnormal placentation, reduced trophoblastic invasion, inadequate uteroplacental perfusion, and ischemia. You can see the percentage of women with ART and preeclampsia, and you can see that there is no patients in control group with preeclampsia and EUGR. What about the Doppler's parameters? In our group and EUGR, there is a pathological findings in uterine arteries, PI above the 95th percentile in 15% of women. And in those without EUGR, we have only 3% of women with abnormal Dopplers. In control group, results are the same with significant difference between the two groups. Those women with EUGR, there is a higher percentage of pathological Doppler parameters, and below 1% women without EUGR and pathological findings. You can see this is a control group. Women with EUGR, there is more cases with uterine arteries abnormality Dopplers. We did not establish a relationship between EUGR and parameters of ART procedure, type of sterility, type of technique used, additional ART techniques, day of embryo transfer, number of transferred embryos. The good blood supply in uterine arteries, radial, spiral, arcuate arteries, and assessment of the color map of the endometrium guarantee the thickness of the endometrium and the successful implantation. Vascular problems in these vessels give rise to defective placentation and impaired maternal fetal blood flow after the conception. Thin endometrium corresponds to defective blood supply. We can expect complications such as EUGR and preeclampsia in women with impaired blood supply to endometrium due to defective remodeling of the uterine arteries. We found a higher number of babies with EUGR for 6.8% in women after ART, in whom the endometrial thickness on the day of embryo transfer is less than 10 millimeters. You can see women with endometrium thickness below 10 millimeters, and you can see 2% of women with EUGR and endometrium more than 10 millimeters on this table. Gestational diabetes is the second complication. Gestational diabetes is carbohydrate intolerance first appeared during pregnancy and affects about 4 to 7% of pregnant women. Risk factors are maternal age, high BMI, family history of diabetes, pre-pregnancy, hypertension, smoking, GnRH stimulation, disorders of thyroid function, PCOS, overweight, complications after pregnancy are predisposition to obesity, metabolic syndrome, later onset diabetes. In our R group, we have women with gestational diabetes in 7.9%, and the difference with control group is significant. We found women in control group, women with gestational diabetes, only 3.4%. The rate of gestational diabetes in our group is higher than control group. This result corresponds to those published before. In our ART group, women 5 years are with gestational diabetes are 6%. Those at the age above 35 years are 10%. In control group, we see the same results. Women below 35 years and gestational diabetes are 2.9%, and those more than 35 years with gestational diabetes are 9.7%. In our group, women with high BMI have gestational diabetes in 15%, in contrary to those with normal BMI and gestational diabetes, which are only 6%. In control group, we see that women with high BMI and gestational diabetes and those with normal BMI and gestational diabetes are almost the same percentage, 4 and 3%. What about the parity? In our group, multipowers and gestational diabetes, we have only 4% of people. Those which are primipares and have a gestational diabetes are 8%. In control group, multipowers with gestational diabetes are 6% and primipares with gestational diabetes are 2%, but difference, statistical difference between the groups. In our group with PCOS and in those without PCOS, we have the same percentage in women with gestational diabetes, 8% and 7%. And the results are the same in the control group, those women with PCOS and without PCOS, with gestational diabetes are almost the same percent without statistical difference between them. What about the thyroid gland disease? Women with thyroid disease, which have gestational diabetes are more than those without thyroid disease, 15% to 6.6% with significant difference in this group. What about the birth weight and fetal macrosomia? In our group and gestational diabetes, fetal weight is more than those in control group and gestational diabetes. Probably the difference is due to higher frequency of gestational diabetes in the R group. Most analyses reported fetal macrosomia in women with gestational diabetes, both after spontaneous pregnancy and after ART. In our R group, women with gestational diabetes have fetal macrosomia in 9%, but in our group, women without gestational diabetes, we detect fetal macrosomia only 1%, with statistical difference between the two groups. In control group, we have the same results. Women with gestational diabetes and fetal macrosomia in 21%, in comparison with those without gestational diabetes and fetal macrosomia only in 3%. In both groups of women, fetal macrosomia was found more frequently in those diagnosed with gestational diabetes. Art has been shown to be an independent risk factor for development of gestational diabetes, but we did not establish a relationship between the day of embryo transfer, the number of embryo transfer, and development of gestational diabetes. The third complication is preeclampsia. Sorry. Preeclampsia was defined as high blood pressure in women with previously normal blood pressure. Preeclampsia complicates 1 to 8% of all pregnancies. Obstetric complications represents a primary cause of prenatal mortality and involves the development of chronic cardiovascular disease. Probable mechanisms for development of preeclampsia after ART are defects in implantation and placentation in the condition of in vitro culture. Various studies have shown many times higher risk of development preeclampsia in women after ART. Abnormal placentation is widely recognized as the primary in pathogenesis of preeclampsia. Defective trophoblastic invasion, impaired spiral arterial remodeling, and placental hypoperfusion. Immunologic factors and immunologic maladaptation, inflammatory and genetic factors. Whether ART or other coexisting risk factors independently contribute to the development of preeclampsia is under debate. In women after ART, we found more women with preeclampsia, 10%, compared to spontaneously pregnant women with preeclampsia, 8.8%. In our group with preeclampsia, the mean maternal age was 36 years, and in control group, the mean maternal age was 30 years, with significant difference between the groups. In our group and preeclampsia, we have women more than 35 years in 60% of cases. Patients in our group and anamnesis for previous arterial hypertension and preeclampsia, we have of cases, and in control group with previous arterial hypertension and preeclampsia, we have only 2.8% of patients. ART women who are overweight developed preeclampsia in 2.6%, and those with normal BMI developed preeclampsia in 6%, with a significant statistical difference between the group. In control group, we have different results. Women who are overweight develop preeclampsia 21%, and in control group with normal BMI develop preeclampsia in 5% of cases. In our group and preeclampsia, we have multiparous women in 7%, and in control group, we have multiparous women with preeclampsia in 27% of cases. In our group, we have preeclampsia and thyroid disease in 23% of cases. Control group, we have a preeclampsia and thyroid disease in 2.8% of cases, with statistical significant difference between the two groups. In a normal pregnancy, placental trophoblast cells invade the inner third of the myometrium and migrate along the entire length of the maternal spiral arteries. In this way, the contribution of oxygen and nutrients are optimized. In women with preeclampsia, a pathological increase in placental vascular resistance is observed, which is visualized by abnormal Doppler blood flow in uterine vessels. Most studies show an increase in RI and PI of the uterine arteries. Doppler examination of the uterine arteries has the potential to predict pregnancy complications that are associated with uteroplacental insufficiency even before clinical manifestation. We find a higher frequency of pathological Doppler's findings of the uterine arteries in the third trimester of pregnancy in women after ART and preeclampsia in 14%, while pathological findings without development of preeclampsia we find only in 2% of women, with a statistically significant difference. In the control group, however, there is no patients with preeclampsia and pathological Doppler findings. Doppler in PI and RI above the 95th percentile measured in the uterine arteries have been associated with pregnancy complications such as preeclampsia, SGA, and EUGR. Doppler features can be used as a useful method for identifying high-risk pregnancy, timely prevention and reduction of perinatal morbidity. In our group, women with preeclampsia has fetal weight more than those in a group without preeclampsia. And in control group, the fetal weight is higher than those in our group. Most studies related to lower birth weight in women after ART show that the main reason for this is related to characteristics of patients in this group and the complication of pregnancy itself, preeclampsia, UGR. In our group with gestational diabetes, we have women with preeclampsia in 21% and those without gestational diabetes, we have preeclampsia in small number of cases, only 9% of women. In control group, the results are the same. We have gestational diabetes and preeclampsia in 21%, and in those without gestational diabetes, we have preeclampsia women in 8%. Gestational diabetes is independent risk factor for preeclampsia. We found no difference in women with preeclampsia and the type of ART procedure used, the type of embryo transfer, fresh or thawed, and additional techniques used, the endometrial thickness of the day of embryo transfer, the day of embryo transfer, and the number of transferred embryos. The incidence of preeclampsia in women after ART is higher than spontaneously pregnant women. After ART, preeclampsia was more commonly found in women at the age over 35. Those with high BMI, thyroid pathology, pre-arterial hypertension, and gestational diabetes. Pregnancies with preeclampsia after ART more often developed UGR and have pathological uterine artery Doppler parameters in the third trimester of pregnancy. The weight of newborn in women with preeclampsia after ART is lower than that in women without preeclampsia. The incidence of gestational diabetes in women after ART is 7.9%. The difference in frequency with spontaneous pregnancies, 3.4%, is statistically significant. Gestational diabetes in women after ART is more common in those over 35 years of age, high BMI, and the presence of thyroid pathology. In women with gestational diabetes, we found more often fetal macrosomia. In pregnant women after ART, the incidence of UGR, 3.1%, is higher than a spontaneous pregnancy, 1%. In this group of patients, UGR was diagnosed more often in women over 35 years old and high BMI. In women with preeclampsia, UGR and pathological changes in Doppler parameters of the uterine arteries are more common. In women who have thickness of the endometrium below 10 millimeters in the day of embryo transfer, we detect more cases with UGR. Our study has several limitations. The retrospective design made it impossible to completely eliminate the potential confounders, such as pregnancy interval and change the partner, which could affect the association between IVF-ICSI procedures and the risk of preeclampsia and other complications. Furthermore, our survey was conducted in a single hospital. Strict criteria for participants also reduced sample size and limit our conclusions. Early detection of pregnant women at risk for pregnancy complication facilitates care thereafter. Appropriate algorithm and screening tests that combine maternal characteristics, biophysical and biochemical markers need to be developed in order to calculate the individual risk for each woman of adverse pregnancy outcome. Early assessment of different complications can improve the outcome of pregnancy by including a series of visits for a more individualized approach. The economic situation of modern society contributes to delaying reproduction and therefore increasing the age of women to realize their reproductive plans. The challenge for assisted reproduction specialists is to achieve such a and gynecologists in maternal and fetal medicine to monitor, detect, prevent, and treat pregnancies at increased risk for number of pregnancies.
Hello. Thank you, Dr. Eskileva. Do we have some questions or opinion from audience?
We don't have written questions. If somebody wants, oh, just a second. Yeah, there's one question. In regard to your study, is it fair to say that age is a better predictor than undergoing art procedures for developing all three complications you discussed? In other words, when you control for age, do the results still hold?
I think that related to general characteristics of women in our survey, in women in our art group. So they are in, most of them are at the age more than 35 years, and maybe this is the main, one of the main predictor for pregnancy complication. But maybe there is another complication, not only the age. I think that one of the most important factor is endometrial and subendometrial blood flow, and not only the age of the women. Doppler parameters of endometrium vessels, spiral arcuate vessels, uterine arteries, not only the age.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Iskeleva. There is no other question from the audience, written question. If somebody wants to ask the question, could raise hand.
Thank you. Please.